My name is Sarah Lane Ritchie. I'm thrilled to be with you today. We're here to talk about the Holy Spirit. And I have to say, I don't know anybody who would talk about the Holy Spirit without quite a fair bit of fear and trembling. You know, there's this whole field that we're going to be talking about today called pneumatology. And I always think that pneumatologists are some of the craziest or most courageous people in the world, because saying anything meaningful about the Spirit is such a tricky thing, and it is so difficult to go wrong. My name is Sarah Lane Ritchie. My field is actually science and theology, so I work at the University of St. Andrews. And doing science and theology, one of the kind of driving motivations behind so much of what I do is to be very critical and to want concrete answers to things and to be able to clearly define what we're talking about and really get my hands around scientific ideas and clear articulations of theology. And when we come to the Holy Spirit, it's very difficult to do that. It's very difficult to apply that same level of rigor and clarity that we like in so many other areas of life. There's one theologian named Wolfhart Pannenberg, and he was fascinated by science and theology and the way that it related to the Holy Spirit, and very famous pneumatologist, which is basically a fancy word for someone who studies the Holy Spirit. And he actually got himself into quite a bit of trouble trying to make the Spirit concrete. He posited that the Holy Spirit is like a force field, but he went even further than that to say it is a force field, right? So there's this constant temptation when we're talking about the Spirit to try and make it overly concrete, and we get into trouble. So as we get started here, I wanna make sure that this really is a conversation. So I'll talk for a few minutes, but I really do want us to break up into groups and we'll kind of collaborate, because when we're talking about the Spirit and what the Spirit does in us, our own personal experiences individually and in community with the Spirit are incredibly important data points for us. And we can't talk about the Spirit meaningfully if we're not talking about the way the Spirit is interacting with us individually and corporately. So, okay, let's get started. When I say the words Holy Spirit, what sorts of images come to your mind? It can be an image or it can be words. And there's no right or wrong answer here. What comes to mind? A dove? Okay. Who else? Holy Ghost, exactly. Yep. Sure. Sure. Yep, exactly. Anybody else? Light or warmth? Very good, yeah. Yes? Inner flame, right. Anybody else? Well, these are all perfect. You're making me feel really good here, because these are some of the ones that we're going to be talking about. Here are some popular images that might kind of come to mind. A dove, we have the dove image. Flames, tongues of fire, you know, spoken of in the New Testament. Wind, kind of comes from the Hebrew word for spirit, which is ruach, which is like wind. And this, does anyone know where this is from? The Shack, exactly. So there's this very controversial book called The Shack, and it's recently been made into a movie. And this movie tried to depict the members of the Trinity in concrete terms that we could visualize. And this is their depiction of the Holy Spirit. A slightly ethereal-looking Asian girl who, very creative, very artistic. So you can debate that in your own time. So when we talk about the Spirit, we have to start with the Trinity. Trinitarian theology is immensely complicated, and we're not going to get into it too deep today. But it's important, I think, to start with the Trinity when we're talking about the Spirit, because it's important to recognize how difficult it is to talk about the Spirit. So when we talk about the Father, God the Father, we kind of are able to get our minds around the concept of God as creator, God as Father, right? There's something kind of, not tangible, but there's a concept there that maps onto experiences that we have in our lives, like relationships that we have in our own lives. So we have God the Father, who's the creator, the source of all life, the sustainer of all life. God the Father is certainly beyond our mental grasp, but there's something about the concept of a creator, God, a creator who brings something out of nothing, that we can sort of come to terms with. And again, we think of God as Father. We think of the parental language surrounding the idea of God the Father allows us to sort of relate in a personal way to God. So we can kind of orient ourselves to God in that way. And then we have the Son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus was a real human being, fully God, fully human, but a real tangible human being. You could have touched him, talked to him, eaten with him. And there's a sense in which we can interact with Jesus. There's something very natural about interacting, obviously, with a real human being. Our minds can't comprehend the incarnation, of course, but we can sort of understand what it would mean to relate to Jesus. But the problem is that when we get to the Spirit, there is just nothing for our minds to latch on to. It's very, very difficult for us to conceptualize how to relate to a Spirit in any meaningful way and in a personal way. And of course, like, a lot of the problem here comes with the way that Spirit, the word Spirit, is used so differently in so many different contexts, right? So we talk about the human spirit, the soul. So what are we talking about there? Is the Holy Spirit like human spirit? And then, of course, we always use metaphors, right, when we talk about spirit. So we might say, you know, oh, that person has a lively spirit, you know? Are we talking about them having, like, a distinct part of themselves that's not really their body and their mind? You know, it's very difficult to kind of pinpoint, like, what we mean by spirit. And of course, there's all kinds of supernatural connotations to the word spirit. So spirits, right? So like think about angels or, you know, demons, you know, in popular culture. So there is a lot of confusion when we're talking about the spirit, and it's difficult to know how to proceed. But one thing that is clear is that whoever the spirit is and whatever the spirit does not fit into our comfortable, tidy boxes. And if we're going to engage with the Spirit, we have to be ready to embrace mystery, to accept intangible realities, and to be open to a being who cannot be constrained, right? It's a very uncomfortable. I kind of think of the Holy Spirit as the most uncomfortable member of the Trinity. Some people call the Holy Spirit the shy member of the Trinity. Right, so who is the Spirit? Well, first we need to look at Spirit language in Scripture. So in Hebrew, in the Old Testament, the Spirit language is often used is often conveyed in the form of ruach, which is sort of this ambiguous word that has some sort of sense of wind or breath. There's a lot of with Spirit language in the Bible. There's a lot of feel and sense and movement and energy, but it's very difficult to pinpoint exactly what the Spirit is and is doing. And in the New Testament, in Greek, it's pneuma, and similarly, we have spirit, breath, and kind of conjures up a feeling of power, movement. And notice that the words for spirit are not masculine, which is interesting because when we talk about God the Father and God the Son, oftentimes we think of God in masculine terms, and the Spirit shifts our categories a bit. The Spirit sort of challenges our preconceptions of what and who God is to us and the qualities that come along with that. Right. So who is the Spirit? The Spirit is God. That is the most important thing. The Spirit is God. So, three persons, one being. In the Old Testament, who do we see the Spirit as being? The Spirit is a being who is creating, life-giving, is teaching, is bringing God's presence to people. And we have, I listed some verses for you here. So, in Genesis 1:2, I love this verse, actually. I'll read it. Genesis 1:1-2. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was moving over the surface of the waters. So even right from the beginning, right from creation, we have the Spirit of God being very involved with nature, being very involved with the creation activities. And we see the Spirit of God has made me. The breath of the Almighty gives me life. So God is creating through the Spirit. When you send your Spirit, they are created and you renew the face of the earth. You gave your good Spirit to instruct them. So the Spirit is a teacher, is instructing. But it is the spirit in a man, the breath of the Almighty that gives him understanding. So again, the learning component, bringing us to God. And then this issue of God's presence. Where can I go from your Spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? So language of the Spirit in the Old Testament is quite different than in the New Testament. And it's in some ways it's less clearly defined than we get when we have Jesus in the early church come on the scene. So we get to the New Testament, and there is different imagery. We hear of people thirsting for the Spirit. We talk about water imagery, again, life and power. We have John the Baptist, who there was a prophecy about John the Baptist that said he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. And then John saying, I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him, meaning Jesus. I would not have known him except that the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. And again, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire, the flame imagery. And then Jesus saying, Jesus himself being born through the Holy Spirit. And then Jesus saying, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. The wind blows wherever it wills. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. And finally, the Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you are spirit, and they are life. So much talk of being born of the Spirit, being filled with the Spirit, and life coming through the Spirit. So the early church, the first Christians, we have the benefit. We today have the benefit of thousands of years of church history to draw upon when we think about the Holy Spirit. But the poor people in the early centuries, the first decades and a couple centuries of the church, they really had to grapple with how to even begin to think about the Holy Spirit and to relate the Spirit to Jesus and the Father. And I'm not going to go through Trinitarian history and theology, you'll be happy to know, but it is important to note the real difficulties in the long period of time that it took for people to kind of come to grips with the Spirit. So, of course, the earliest Christians knew about the Spirit from Scripture, the Old Testament in particular. And we had the Spirit being linked to God's creative activity. We saw that, but then when we get to Jesus, the Spirit was involved with Jesus's birth and ministry, and then after Jesus, we have the Spirit coming and being a counselor for the early church, bringing power to the disciples to heal people physically and to bring spiritual life to people. So we have Acts saying, Peter saying, repent and be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So the kind of a sense of the Holy Spirit being tied to new life in Christ. And then now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So we have freedom being a mark of the Spirit. And one of the jobs, the roles of the Spirit is to bring freedom, to bring life. And again, in Romans, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Spirit you may abound in hope. And then we get to all these debates. The first, it takes time to kind of hash through all the theology for the early church. So we have in the first council of Nicaea in 325, they spent a lot of time trying to figure out how Jesus could be fully God and fully human. They didn't spend so much time on the Spirit. So they affirmed belief in the Holy Spirit, but they didn't really say much else. And it was like they needed to focus on the relationship between the Father and Jesus before they could move on to anything else. And it kind of makes an intuitive sort of sense in a way to us, because it's with Jesus, at least, you had a tangible human being that you could be talking about and a kind of a concrete problem. And it was really difficult at the beginning to figure out how are we going to talk about the Spirit in relationship to God and the Father. And there are endless debates about this, and these debates are still raging. So a lot of controversy about how exactly the relationship between the Father, Son, and Spirit play out. So what happened after Nicaea is that people started talking about the Spirit almost as if the Spirit was like an angel, like a created being. And so there's a real backlash to that, and there's a real sense that, no, there's something important about the Spirit, something divine and truly God about the Spirit, and it was important not to lose that. So what we have is people like Athanasius, one of the early church fathers, coming along and insisting that the Spirit is God. And I love this quote by him. He says, "But if we become sharers in the divine nature through participation in the Spirit, one would have to be crazy to say that the Spirit is of a created nature and not of the nature of God. For that is how those in whom the Spirit is become divinized or become like God." And then we have the Cappadocian Fathers, which is basically Basil of Caesarea, Gregory of Nyssa, and Gregory of Nazianzus, another few early church fathers who kind of standardize the language about the Trinity and three persons and one substance. And I love this Gregory of Nazianzus quote, "And when I speak of God, you must be illumined at once by one flash of light and by three." So really kind of trying to nail down the three in one nature of the Trinity. So who is the Spirit? The Spirit is God, existing and loving in relationship with the Father and the Son. The Spirit never acts alone, always alongside the Father and the Son in unity. The energetic love of the Spirit in relation to the Father and the Son is reflected and manifest in the Spirit's activity in the world. And this is important. So God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, says Galatians 4:6. So I suggest that we embrace the mystery of the Spirit. I think there's something really important. A lot of times it's easy to want to really put all the mysteries that we experience into categories and to kind of do away with the mystery if at all possible. And I think this is one area where it's not only appropriate but actually necessary to welcome the mystery and sort of the intangible, the unknowable about God. We will always come up against the limits of language and thought when we're thinking and talking about the Spirit. We'll never really be able to grasp the Spirit's ontology, so the nature of the Spirit, but how could it be otherwise? Yes, so, and also, this is the a bit of the final Nicene Creed. Sorry, apologies. "And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life. He proceeds from the Father and the Son, and with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified. He spoke through the prophets." So this bit about the "he proceeds from the Father and the Son," does anybody know what this is called in theological circles? No? Yes? Say it. Can you say it louder? Yes, yes, yes. I'll let you Google that one on your own. It's a point of real heated debate amongst theologians about how to understand the Spirit coming from the Father and the Son. Right, so it's very difficult to talk about who the Spirit is, the ontology of the Spirit, and sometimes it's best to talk about how we can know the Spirit through what the Spirit does. So there's this idea that if we can understand what the Spirit does in the world, in us and for us, and in nature, then we can kind of get at the heart of who the Spirit is and who God is. Right, so the Spirit is involved in creation. As I read from Genesis, we have even this early creation imagery of the Spirit hovering over the waters, being involved with creation from the very beginning. And there's a sense, it's kind of been lost in the Western tradition, but especially in the Eastern Orthodox tradition, there's a real sense in which the Spirit is integral to what it means for nature to be truly natural. And this is actually an important point, because we live in an age when everything is, we like everything to be very scientific. We like our categories about the natural world to be defined by science. And we sometimes struggle as Christians to talk about how to talk about God in relationship to nature, right? So we think about the natural world and we think about the supernatural world. We think about creation as sort of this like a law-governed mechanism. And then we think about God as sometimes being like over here and then stepping in every once in a while to intervene in natural processes. But this is actually a very foreign idea for many of the tradition, many Christian traditions, and in Scripture itself. And there's really a role to talk about the Spirit in relationship to the natural world. So one stream of pneumatology at the moment talks about how we even define nature to begin with, right? So what does it mean for nature to be truly natural, right? Does it mean that we can just define nature by physical laws? Or can we think about nature theologically? Can we think about nature inherently being involved with the Spirit at all times and all places? And that actually helps us to think about the Spirit acting in the world, the Spirit moving, divine action, what we might call miracles. When we think about nature participating in God, participating in the Spirit, who is active and creative at all times, it does something to help our problems with thinking about divine intervention. So we can talk about that later, but that's a really, I think it's a really important thing to keep in mind when we're talking about the relationship between the Spirit and physical processes that scientists would describe. And this is just a quote that I find very helpful. Spirit matters are the most natural things that there are. Nature is spirit graced to its core, so that what is fundamentally characteristic of nature is that it is spirit related. So just some food for thought. So another job of the Spirit is to work in Christ and to apply Christ's work to us, right? So we come to Christ through the Spirit. Jesus lived thousands of years ago, but is still made present to us through the Spirit. Jesus was born in the Spirit. He did his ministry in the Spirit. He lived, died, and resurrected by the power of the Spirit. He sent the Spirit as a counselor to people to draw them into wisdom and to truth. The work of Christ is applied to us through the Spirit. And these verses from Titus, he saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. Another role of the Holy Spirit is to illuminate us, to illuminate our hearts. 2 Corinthians 2:10 says, these are the things that God has revealed to us by his Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. And illumination gets to this idea of prevenient grace, something that Wesleyans talk about quite a bit. This idea that the Spirit goes before us. The Spirit is working in us before we're even aware of our need for God. So God doesn't wait for us to come to him before he responds to us, right? The Spirit calls us. We wouldn't even long for God in the first place. We wouldn't have a desire for God in the first place if the Spirit was not acting in us to begin with. So this sense that grace is mediated to us through the Spirit before we're even aware or looking for any salvation, looking for hope. And I love this. This is from the Book of Common Order in 1564 onwards, I believe. And I'll just try out my Scots here. This rubric here is sort of the outline of what the minister would do before he did his sermon, right? So this says, this done, the people sing a psalm together, all together in a plain tune, which ended, the minister prayeth for the assistance of God's Holy Spirit, as the same shall move his heart. And so proceedeth to the sermon. So that this idea that the minister would pray for the Holy Spirit to come into the parishioners' hearts, to open their eyes, to draw them into a place where they were receptive and able to hear the word of God. And it's only then that the word can be effective. So this is very much a Church of Scotland emphasis. The Spirit empowers us. So Acts 1:8 says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And one way to think about empowerment is through prayer. So the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through words and groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. So the real sense in which we're not even able to pray as we should without the Spirit. And when we pray, the Spirit empowers us not only to know God, but to know ourselves, to pray the right words, to pray beyond words sometimes. The Spirit is kind, loving, and dynamic. By empowering us to pray, the Spirit draws us into a felt, experiential knowledge of God, getting beyond abstractions. And of course, the Spirit empowers us to live as Christians, right? And the Spirit is the one who empowers us to make lifestyle choices, to experience hope, to experience freedom, to move concretely from one place in our life to another. Life change happens because of the Spirit. And the Spirit inspires us. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. The inspiration of the Holy Spirit is a really interesting thing because it doesn't just get fleshed out in one way, right? The Spirit inspires us to produce art, music, poetry, bring order to chaos, to challenge unjust political structures. The work of the Spirit is not one thing. I have here Rembrandt's Prodigal Son painting as one example of inspiration by the Holy Spirit. The saving work of Jesus was indeed the definitive revelation of God to the world, but it's the Spirit who continues to work in and with humans to reveal the truth of Christ and bring healing to a broken world. For where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Christians are called to be creative partners with the Spirit in dynamically engaging very specific ways with the world around us. I'm not going to read all of this, but I love this Veni Creator Spiritus. It's an ancient Christian hymn. It's written in the 9th century, I believe. And they really have a grasp on these roles of the Holy Spirit that I've been talking about. Come, Holy Ghost, Creator, come from thy bright heavenly throne. Come, take possession of our souls and make them all thine own. So that real sanctifying kind of work of the Holy Spirit. Thou who art called the Paraclete, which is the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete, best gift of God above, the living spring, the living fire, sweet unction and true love. O guide our minds with thy blessed light. So the real emphasis on instruction and in God empowering us to see truth. With love our hearts inflame, and with thy strength which never decays, confirm our mortal frame. So I'll just leave that there, but look it up sometime. It's a beautiful hymn. And finally, the Holy Spirit is in the business of healing. Last night, I had the pleasure of being at the Dennis Duncan Lecture at St. George's Tron Church in Glasgow. And it was put on by the Guild of Health in St. Raphael. Was anyone here or there? Anyone? There are quite a few Church of Scotland folks there. And David Lunan was the speaker. And David Lunan is a former moderator of the General Assembly for the Church of Scotland and has been very involved in healing ministry. And he gave the most powerful and remarkable lecture, if we can call it a lecture, last night, about his work as a Church of Scotland minister, experiencing the Holy Spirit in really transformative and powerful ways. And so he kind of went through and talked about healing in a variety of contexts. And it was not what you would expect from a Church of Scotland minister because it just wasn't a very Presbyterian kind of lecture, right? We don't really think about the healing ministry except in more charismatic circles, perhaps. But it was a remarkable thing. And David Lunan, he kind of walked through the history of the theology of the ministry of healing in the Church of Scotland and emphasize that it's okay for us to reclaim an understanding of the Spirit that is vibrant and alive and ready to do things that might be really uncomfortable for us. And we need to think about healing, the healing role, the healing ministry of the Spirit in a very expansive way, of course, right? So we're talking about spiritual healing, forgiveness, union with God. These are things that are, this is a sort of spiritual healing that is brought by the Spirit. And emotional healing, you know, this is an interesting idea. The Spirit can heal our minds and emotions, right? Painful memories, scars, broken relationships. It's interesting to think about, like, what would it mean to engage with the Spirit to bring about healing in people's lives in that way? And in physical healing, you know, one of the most important roles of the Holy Spirit in the New Testament was to bring about physical healing, not only through the work of the ministry of Jesus Christ, but also through the work of his disciples. And it's very easy for us today, I think, to forget that God is interested in our bodies, God is interested in our minds and our spirits, and that being the church doesn't have to just be about, or shouldn't just be about, cerebral activities and abstractions. And I love this quote. So David Lunin closed with this quote yesterday, and it says, it's by a theologian named Hans Kuhn, and he wrote that God's kingdom is creation healed. And it's a very expansive understanding of the Spirit's work, and I think it's appropriate, though. It might be very tempting to be wary of the Spirit. The Spirit resists definition, containment, and control. And the Spirit is not tame, right? It can be unsettling to recognize or affirm the Spirit's activity in or around us when it might draw us outside of our comfort zones. But it is in just these times that Christians can remember and take comfort in knowing that the Spirit is God, the same God who lovingly created us, the same God who brings salvation and hope and joy through Jesus Christ. When we live in the Spirit, we are comforted even as we are stretched and challenged. Life in the Spirit is an adventure, but one which is full of the assurance of God's love and presence. And as we move into a discussion time, I'd like us to ask ourselves, in addition to the questions in the book, if we could ask ourselves, how open are we to the Spirit? Do we have kind of parameters within which we're okay with the Spirit moving, but others which we are more reluctant to accept? What are our expectations around the Spirit? Are we afraid of not being able to control where the Spirit might lead us? And what about when the Spirit seems hidden? What about when God seems absent? There's a hiddenness of God that is an immensely painful experience for many people. What happens when we don't feel God? What happens when we don't feel the Spirit as comforter or counselor or teacher or God's presence? All this talk of the Spirit reminds me of C.S. Lewis in his Narnia books. And as I'm sure most of you will know, there's a Christ-like figure named Aslan, who's a lion in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. And at one point, there's this great quote. It's like, he's wild, you know. He's not like a tame lion. And there's this great imagery there. You know, the Holy Spirit is not tame. But there's another line in this book by Lewis where one of the characters is asked about Aslan, the Jesus God figure, really. Well, is he safe? And the response through one of the characters is, no, of course he's not safe, but he's good. I'll close with that. Thanks very much.